The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. Life after death holds an unending fascination for everyone. Most of our interest, however, centers on life in either heaven or hell, and the possibility of ghosts and ghostly visitations. But in the summer of 1908, in the tiny hamlet of Visalia, Ohio, there was turmoil because of the imminent arrival of a man who claimed he had the power to bring the dead to life.
Lucas, you're the mayor of this town. Now, if there's any chance of me getting my daughter Phyllis back, then it's up to you.
Yeah, get yourself all worked up, Mary.
Yes, Mary, your daughter's dead. It's a sin even to think of bringing her back to life. I say this Chardon should be ridden out of town on a rail.
And now just back off, both of you. Nobody's being ridden out of Visalia while I'm mayor. And as for this professor raising the dead, well, we've got 5 days before he even comes to town to sit and think about it.
Our mystery drama, The Dead Come Alive, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Murray Burnett and stars Marion Seldes and Ralph Bell. I'll be back shortly with Act One. The Holy Bible gives us only one instance of the dead being brought to life.
That miracle is accomplished by Jesus when he calls upon Lazarus to come forth, and Lazarus does. It's one thing when Jesus did it, but quite another when a mere mortal, a man of no particular distinction, claims that he can duplicate this miracle. Not only claims it, but says that he will prove it. That was the situation in the little town of Visalia, Ohio, in 1908, as the townspeople awaited his arrival with high but mixed emotions.
What is so funny, Ralph?
Oh, Sheriff. Those darn fools standing in the road gawking, waiting for that professor to come into town. Maybe they expect him to fly in or swoop down out of the clouds. They make me laugh.
You won't be doing much laughing when Professor Marbelli brings your Rachel back to life and you find yourself with two wives. Have you talked to Edith about that?
No, and I don't intend to, because this is just a clever way of doing business. This here notice he put up in the post office about raising the dead is just a come-on. He probably runs a traveling circus or a carnival.
And if he doesn't?
Then I figure the sheriff here and the mayor have themselves some kind of problem. Because the man must be either crazy or a demon.
It's him! Look! It's him! Professor Marbelli, he's in one of those newfangled horseless carriages.
Calm down, Mary, please.
Mayor, I want you to promise that you'll listen to what he has to say. Oh, Lucas, do you think he can really do it? Bring the dead back to life? Do you think I'll see my Phyllis again?
It's kind of hard to believe, Mary.
But this notice here, says, exactly at midnight on the 19th of July, Professor Leon Marbelli will be in the Atwood Cemetery of the town of Visalia. He will bring the dead to life. Any who wish to see their loved ones again as they were in the flesh will please attend. Signed, Professor...
I know, Mary. I saw the notice in the post office. Those are just words. Anyone can print up a notice like that.
And anyone who did and then failed to deliver would be a sorry human being indeed, sir. I believe I am addressing Mayor Lucas Kane.
Yes, and you must be Professor Marbelli.
Lucas.
And this is Mrs. Mary Thatcher.
I want to ask you, Professor.
Mary, the professor and I have a lot to talk about. I'd appreciate some privacy.
Oh, Lucas.
Please, Mary, excuse us. Now, Professor,
If you'll be so good as to step into my office here. Professor, I wonder if you realize that you caused more excitement in Vesalia than anything since the fair in St. Louis a few years ago.
I resent that, Mr. Kane.
Oh? Why? How can what I've said...
Because, Mr. Mayor, you are lumping me in your mind with a carnival. A circus atmosphere. I assure you, this is a serious matter. Most serious.
I'm keenly aware of that.
Then you are probably not personally involved.
My wife of 28 years died 2 years ago, Professor. She lies at Atwood Cemetery today.
You are a most unusual man, Mr. Mayor, to remain so calm when in a few days you can face the prospect of being reunited with your beloved.
Yes, well, perhaps I do owe you an apology for my remark about the St. Louis Exposition. You see, Professor, I would be both excited and apprehensive if I believed you.
Well, I understand your skepticism. Perhaps these may change your mind.
Huh?
As you can see, the majority of these letters are from various small towns in Europe. But that's because I've only been in America a short time. Now, here is one from a little New England village. Dunslip. As you can also see, it's signed by the mayor.
All right, just hold on. Just give me a chance here to read these, and we'll continue our conversation. Very impressive, Professor. Very impressive. I really don't know what to say.
Well, what is there to say? You have read the letters. You accept them as genuine.
They appear to be exactly as you represent them, yes.
Meaning you intend to check them out?
Well, as the mayor of this hamlet, I feel it's my duty to protect the citizens from what could be a very cruel hoax.
Yes, well, that is why my first visit was to you, to reassure you. Have I succeeded?
Well, let me answer that by saying that before you showed those letters, I was convinced that you were a charlatan. And now I'm not so certain.
Well, that is the first step on the road to belief.
Why are you doing this, Professor? And why did you pick Vesalia?
Yes, well, you see, I studied for many years the ancient religions, even witchcraft, which, sir, I abhor. And in my studies, I employed the latest sciences, chemistry, electricity. And, sir, I made a discovery. I can bring the dead to life. And by so doing, I can bring happiness to many who are bereaved and be paid for doing this service.
I see. So it's a business with you.
It's a unique service. A service which deserves to be paid.
Mm. And why Vesalia?
Well, obviously, most people will be skeptical, or even worse, openly antagonistic. Therefore, I must select a village small enough for me to display my ability as, say, a sort of a sample that will convince everyone.
Oh, then your demonstration won't raise the whole population at Atwood Cemetery.
Oh, hardly, hardly. Although it would be possible. There will be certain people I'll select. Now, for example, you mentioned you were a widower. Yes? Now, if you will give me your wife's name...
I'm still trying to make up my mind about you, Professor, so let's leave my wife out of this.
Yes, yes, as you choose, sir.
What about the appearance? Surely some of those...
Corpses?
May have been dead for some time.
Well, as my printed announcement stated, Mr. Mayor, the appearance will be exactly as it was in their lifetime, or on the day they... passed over.
Yes, but some people died after a long and wasting illness. Others may have died violent deaths. Perhaps they were even disfigured. So
when a person is restored to life, that person cannot, by the very nature of the act, have any marks of death upon them.
Who is it? Yes, who is it?
This is Thatcher. Mary Thatcher. Remember, we met at the mayor's office.
Ah, yes. Come in, Mrs. Thatcher. Well, how did you get my room number?
Oh, you mustn't be angry with Jonesy. We've known each other a long time, and I begged him, and he told me. Oh, please say you forgive him.
Yes, of course, of course. Now, how may I help you, Mrs. Thatcher?
Well, how did you make out with the mayor? Is he going to try and stop you?
My dear Mrs. Thatcher, surely you didn't go to all the trouble of finding out my hotel room to come and ask a question which you could just as easily have asked the mayor.
No, no, this is important. You see, 3 years ago, my daughter, Phyllis, was murdered.
Ah.
And they never caught the person who did it. And I, Miss Phyllis, and I was wondering what can happen. I mean, will Phyllis remember? And will she know the person who tried to kill her?
I see your problem, Mrs. Thatcher.
Well, what happens?
I suggest you come Saturday night and find out.
Lucas! Hey, Lucas!
Huh?
Hold up a minute. You sure set a good pace, Lucas. I guess I'm not as young as I used to be.
Who is? What's up, Gary?
It's interesting you deciding to visit the cemetery. Come here often?
Would I feel like it?
Uh-huh. And I imagine you're feeling like it now. Particularly since we're only 2 days away from Saturday.
What do you want, Kerry?
I've just come from a meeting with some concerned citizens.
Mm-hmm. No names, hmm?
Well, let's just say they're important people. The kind of people who swing elections.
I'm asking you again, Kerry. What do you want?
We want to know what you're going to do about this Marvelli and his demonstration.
I haven't made up my mind.
You know, this shouldn't be allowed.
Not everyone agrees with you.
But this Marvelli's a fake. He's got to be.
Yeah, that's what I figured. But he's got some mighty powerful credentials. Letters of recommendation from very important people.
They could have been forged.
Yeah, that occurred to me. So I sent off a telegram to the mayor of Dunslip, a little New England town where Marvelli had given a demonstration. Do you care to read the answer I got today?
No, no, I'll believe what you tell me.
The mayor wired me that Marvelli's no fake. He can do what he says he'll do, bring the dead to life.
Mr. Rea.
Oh, Professor. I was just closing up shop for the day.
Yes, I have something I think you should see.
Do I have to open up my office again, or...
No, I can show it to you if you'll walk me back to the hotel.
Good deal. I ate quite a few meals there since Willa died. I'm not much of a cook, I guess.
Sir, that could all be straightened out this Saturday night. You could be eating home again.
Well, I'd be lying if I didn't admit that I've thought about that. But it's kind of... sort of gives me a weird feeling.
Yes, well, it takes getting used to, and that's a fact. And I know some people never get used to it. Like the committee.
The what?
The people who had this note slipped under the door of my hotel room a little while ago. I'd like you to read it.
Forget Saturday night and forget your demonstration. You'd better start thinking about how to bring yourself back to life. You've been warned. Signed, the committee. Well, Professor, I thought I knew the people of this town pretty well. But you haven't been here 24 hours, and you've turned them into something kind of ugly.
Not me, Mr. Mayor. It was always there. Must have been. Now, any ideas on the makeup of this committee?
None that I care to make public until I do some checking. And let me assure you, Professor, I'm going to do a lot of checking. And so is the sheriff. I won't have this kind of ugliness in Visalia.
Here we are at the hotel. I would eat with you, but I'm afraid that might prejudice some of the townspeople against you. So...
Down, Professor, down!
Now, we all know that no one can bring the dead back to life. It's simply impossible. But what about testimonials from reputable people swearing that this was true? Would that change your mind? I confess I'm beginning to have doubts, which will be resolved when we return shortly with Act Two. Famous Victor Herbert love song goes, "Ah, sweet mystery of life, at last I found you." But today's mystery involves a man who claims to have found the mystery of death. Not only found it, but solved it. And he goes around bringing the dead back to life, which gives rise to some problems.
Darn it, Lucas, I'm the sheriff. Now, this has been a fairly peaceable town till now. Now, we can't have people going around taking shots at other people.
That's why I told you about it, Sheriff.
You could hardly have kept it a secret. About 20 people heard the shot, and at least a dozen saw you and this Marvelli fella hit the dirt.
If I wanted to keep secrets, I wouldn't have shown you the note.
Okay. Now you and I got a pretty good notion of at least one of the members of this committee. You want me to face him with it?
You mean Kerry Windham?
Well, he's the one that's been making most of the noise.
Yeah, but he surely ain't going to admit having anything to do with this note threatening to kill Marvelli.
Hey, Lucas, now you're going to have to make a stand, and soon. Did you hear me, Lucas?
I'm sorry. Daydreaming again.
Yeah, I know. I could see it in your eyes. You really think there's something to this, huh?
Well, if I do, I'm not the only one.
You can't count poor Mary Thatcher. She's been a little off the rails ever since Phyllis was killed.
Yeah, I wasn't thinking of Mary. I was thinking of someone who was so scared that the professor might be able to bring the dead back to life that he or she was trying to kill him to stop him.
Thunderation! Now, why didn't I think of that, huh? Of course! As far as I know, Phyllis Thatcher is the only person buried in Atwood Cemetery was murdered. Now, there may be others, but she's enough. Now, if this professor brings her back to life, she sure shooting will be able to name her killer.
That's what I was thinking.
Yes, and that's all the more reason for you to say that you're going to see to it that the demonstration is held. I'll put a deputy to guard the professor.
And tip off the murder? Oh, no, sir. Pete, you just hold everything for a while.
All right. Quiet down now, everyone. Let's listen to Kerry.
Thank you, Ralph. Without all this gabbing and fussing, I take it that the sense of this meeting is to let Mayor Lucas know that the people of Visalia ain't going to put up with any unholy goings-on in Atwood Cemetery or anywhere else. And that we, the people, want him as the mayor to tell that to this Marvelli.
That's right. I, for one, vote that you be the man to tell him.
Professor, Mary Thatcher again. Please open the door. It's very important.
Ah, please, Mrs. Thatcher.
I want you to come with me to the cemetery right away.
You're terribly upset. Please, come in. Sit down.
They're going to stop you, you know. They're going to stop you, and that's why I want you to come with me right now.
Who is going to stop me?
The mayor. I've just come from a meeting, and most of the important people in town were there, and they're sending Kerry Windham to the mayor to get him to stop you. And that's why you must come with me to the cemetery right now, so you can bring Phyllis back.
Not until Saturday night, Mrs. Thatcher.
But the mayor won't let you.
I have reason to believe that the mayor not only won't try to stop me, but actually will help me.
But I've just told you
that. The mayor was very much in love with his wife. Don't you agree, Mrs. Thatcher?
Well, they had a perfect marriage. Everyone knows that, but... Oh, you mean Mayor Lucas thinks you really can. But when I was in his office the other day, I got the impression he really didn't believe you could.
Well, he doesn't want to get his hopes up, Mrs. Thatcher. Mark my words. We'll have the demonstration Saturday night, and the mayor will be there.
I didn't come to your office to play games, Lucas.
Yeah, hold on a minute, Carrie.
You've got to ban the demonstration and run this Marvelli fella out of town.
Out of the question. What grounds do I have for asking him to leave town?
Witchcraft, Lucas. That's what he's practicing.
Oh, come now, Carrie. This is the 20th century. I'm not going to restage the Salem witchcraft trials here in Visalia.
Now, who's talking about trials?
Oh, what are we talking about? Lynching? Tarring and feathering? What have the people of this town turned into?
God-fearing, public-spirited citizens.
All who just happen to have relatives buried at Atwood Cemetery.
That's exactly right. Now, Lucas, you trying to make it out that there's something wrong with people who don't want their dead disturbed?
And what about you, Carrie? You don't have anyone at Atwood unless you count Phyllis Thatcher. I believe she used to work for you before she was killed.
And what's that supposed to mean?
Just what I said. Nothing more, nothing less.
What you're insinuating is so vile that you ought to be made to pay for it. Believe me, Lucas Kane, this is something I ain't forgetting. I'll make you eat your words, or I'll...
I don't know what you're talking about, Carrie. All I said
was... I heard you, Lucas, and by heaven, you can thank the Lord I haven't got a horse with, because I...
What's going on here? You and Carrie sound like you're thinking of starting your own private war.
Now, Sheriff, you better talk some sense into Lucas. He's heading for a peck of trouble.
Yeah, well, old Lucas is always stubborn, Carrie. You ought to know that.
Now, this is a serious matter, Sheriff, and you can be in trouble, too, unless you can persuade Lucas to stop this godless demonstration in Edward. Your job is to run Marvelli out of town.
Be with you in a minute.
No hurry, Ralph. I'm not a customer.
Okay. Back so soon? Just let me lock up and you'll tell me how it went with Mayor Lucas. Down near closing time anyway.
We got trouble, Ralph.
Lucas still backing and filling, is he?
Oh, yeah. And I don't think we're going to get much help from the sheriff either.
Yeah, I figured that.
You did? Then why did you send me over there?
Because you'll sound more convincing for what I got in mind.
Well, we don't have much time. Today's Thursday. Saturday's coming up on us fast. What's the idea?
Money.
No wonder you're the richest man in Visalia. You think money can fix everything.
Name me one thing it can't.
Death.
Funny you should say that. Because I'm betting that money's going to keep the dead dead.
The professor doesn't need money.
Everybody needs money.
You're going to try to bribe the professor?
You use the wrong words. We're going to make a business deal with the professor.
You have any idea on how much he wants?
I know what we're going to offer him.
We?
We're all in it together. We're all going to chip in.
How much?
How much is it worth to you, Carrie?
How much are you putting in?
Look, I'll show you the figure we're going to offer him, and then we'll decide on how we're going to prorate it.
You seem to have it all worked out.
Oh, I figured it would end up like this, and I've been thinking about it. Now, here's the amount.
Ooh, that's quite a sum. Where are we going to get that kind of money?
Well, here's another sheet of paper. A list of names and the amounts that you and I expect them to contribute. It all adds up.
And suppose these people don't want Andy?
That's why I want you to go along with me to help persuade them.
Come in. Come in, gentlemen. Make yourselves comfortable. Well, I am sorry I cannot offer you any refreshments.
We are not interested in the refreshments.
Well, you already know, Mr. Windham, my name is Ralph Jameson. I own a hardware store down the street.
Ah, yes, yes. I would like to know the purpose of your visit.
Business, Professor, business. We're here solely on a matter of business.
Professor, There are a lot of people who don't want you to put on that demonstration tomorrow.
Yes, I am well aware of that, Mr. Wyndham.
Are you also aware that these people are willing to pay you a nice round sum for you to cancel?
Oh, dear me, that does present a problem.
Uh-huh. But not, I hope, an insoluble one?
Well, Mr. Jameson, in my profession, I would be the last person in the world to say anything was insoluble. Particularly if there is cooperation.
What's the problem?
Well, a number of people are desperately anxious to witness the demonstration.
But not so anxious that they've offered to pay for it.
Oh, no, not yet, not yet. But past experience has proven that people who are anxious quite often...
$3,000, Professor.
Well, I know you don't intend it as such, but that is an insult.
Ah, let's quit horsing around. How much you want?
I haven't even mentioned what this cancellation will do to my reputation.
How much?
10,000.
I said we were businessmen, not a terrible institution. We just might be able to go to four.
7,500.
You're pricing yourself out of the market. We might just be forced to let the demonstration go on. Now, Professor, I want you to look me straight in the eye, and you'll know bargaining time is over. Our final offer, $5,000.
Cash. No checks.
Cash.
Yes, well, we have a deal. Oh, but there is one other matter.
I told you the bargaining was finished.
This does not concern money.
Well?
Yes. Well, you understand, this is my life work. Now, I am willing to call off the demonstration to accommodate you, sir. But I must have a letter from the mayor saying that my demonstration was indeed held and was successful.
The mayor wasn't part of this negotiation.
Nevertheless, I must have the letter. Believe me, sir, this issue is not negotiable. Without the letter, there is no deal.
Understood. We'll be back this evening with the money and the letter.
Lucas will never agree to write such a letter, and you know it, Ralph.
You may be right, Carrie.
Then how could you commit yourself to deliver the money and the letter tonight?
Do you want that demonstration called off?
You know I do.
Then we darn well better put our heads together and find a way to persuade Lucas to write the letter. Or find another alternative.
I heard the professor, and I just don't think there is any. Short of murder.
At most, anything that's ever been said has been said best by Shakespeare. And speaking of murder, the famous bard said, "For murder, though it hath no tongue, will speak with most miraculous organ." It would certainly be a miracle if a girl would rise from the dead to point an accusing finger at her murderer. We'll find out in Act 3. In a cemetery. The classical setting for hauntings and dark deeds done when the moon hides behind a cloud. But the little town of Visalia was looking forward to a tumultuous, rousing demonstration put on by a man who claimed to be able to raise the dead.
Stupid machine. Do what you're supposed to, you stubborn ignorant.
That's why I stick to my horse, Professor.
Yes, well, I do not sit well on a horse, Mr. Mayor. So I use this modern miracle.
Yeah, if tonight's demonstration is a success, there are going to be a lot of folks who will figure you can just get up on your broomstick and fly away.
Tonight's demonstration?
Yep, you laid down a challenge to me and the sheriff, and we accepted it. We'll be there.
There is something very wrong here. Mr. Mayor, I want you to look at this.
What's this? I never wrote this letter.
Yes, but it is on official stationery, and it is signed by you.
A forgery. Who gave it to you?
Oh, dear me. It would have been so much simpler for all of us had my machine started.
You figured you'd have been home free after you skedaddled.
Well, I was leaving, true, but in a perfectly honorable fashion. I thought you all knew about it.
Well, now you know I don't. So you just tell me who gave you the letter.
Oh, dear me, I fear that would lead only to complications.
I hope so.
If I give you the name, would you then allow me to leave immediately?
What's your hurry?
Well, I wish only to avoid the complications that you look forward to.
You're in no position to bargain. You show me a forgery and say that you got it from somebody you refuse to name. It just could be that you wrote that letter yourself, since it sure as shooting gives you a good reference.
Yes, I see your point.
Then let's have the name.
Carrie Wyndham.
Before anybody says anything, I just want to let you know, Lucas, that I have work to do in the church, and I don't appreciate the sheriff dragging me over to your office in the middle of the afternoon.
I think you know Professor Marvelli.
Yeah, sure. Now, what's this on about?
Have you ever seen this letter before?
No.
Don't you think you ought to take a look at it before speaking up, Carrie?
What? Oh, sure. Let me see it. Like I said, I never saw it.
Well, now, the professor says that you gave it to him.
You ought to know better than to believe anything he says.
If you don't believe me, perhaps you'd believe Mr. Ralph Jameson. I suggest you check with him.
Good afternoon, Sheriff. Professor, what brings you down to my shop today?
Somebody forged Lucas' name to a letter. A letter sort of giving the professor a pat on the back. Now, he claims Carrie Wyndham gave it to him. Now, Carrie denies it, and the professor said to check with you, so, well, I'm checking.
Well, I'm glad. It's time for both of us to face up to what's been happening and what might happen.
I'm asking about the letter.
I made a business deal with the professor. He agreed to cancel the demonstration.
For the letter?
For $5,000.
Enough of this evasion. I am used to being met with mistrust and skepticism, but not with deceit, cowardice, and lies.
Now, you just hold on a second. You admit we made a deal and I forked over $5,000?
Which I will now proceed to return to you.
Oh, not so fast. You can't just decide to...
With the treatment I have received here, I can do anything I want. Mr. Jameson, here is your money. The demonstration will proceed as scheduled.
We made a deal. You can't back out now just by giving back the money.
You didn't keep your bargain. The letter was a fake.
Oh, I'll get you a good one. I'll go to Mayor Lucas myself. The time has come for straight talk between me and the mayor.
Well, how about straight thinking, Ralph? You call yourself a businessman, and you let this here con artist pick your pocket on nothing but empty promises. Lucas knows he can't deliver.
That's not the question. Lucas has been so wrapped up in thinking about him and Willa that he never even bothered about anyone else. If by any chance the professor can deliver, what happens to me and Edie when Rachel comes back and finds us married, Or all the others who've made lives for themselves? What happens to them, Sheriff?
Oh, nothing. He's just a faker.
Your words echo your ignorance. Never once did you ask about the difficulty of working this miracle, or the danger of dealing with those forces I unloose. But tonight, Sheriff, you and Mayor Lucas come and see for yourself. Yes, if you have the courage.
Well, what do you really think, Lucas? Do you think that the professor has any chance of raising the dead?
Yes, somebody does. Somebody who's a murderer and whose whole attention is focused on not being caught, or even chance it. He's willing to kill again. Took a shot at the professor.
Or forged your letter.
Yeah, maybe. Now, that's why we're going to Carrie's house. Gotta get to the bottom of that letter.
There you go. I'll tie him up. You tell Martha we're coming.
Lucas Kane and the sheriff
Don't tell me you're coming to see me.
No, Martha. We wanted to talk to Gary.
Oh, that's a shame. He came home a while ago looking, feeling so poorly, I sent him right to bed.
Yeah. Well, I'm sorry, Martha, but it's real important that we talk with him. Tell him that we're here and we'll be waiting in the parlor.
Hope we can make this short, Lucas. Martha told you I was under the weather.
That's up to you. All you have to do is tell us the truth about that letter.
I never should have gone along with Ralph. I knew he was too sharp for me.
Are you saying that Ralph wrote that letter?
He talked me into writing it.
You mean he paid you?
No, not a penny. It was easy. He knew I wanted that evil demonstration stopped.
Yeah, badly enough to forge my name on a letter.
Carrie done what he thought was right. You ought to leave him alone.
Martha, you know something about this letter?
Well, just what I hear now. And, of course, what I heard at the meeting we had about raising the dead. No God-fearing person can hold with that.
Carrie, you must know forgery is a serious crime.
What the professor was fixing to do was a bigger crime.
And that's your entire stake in this?
Oh, don't sound so surprised. I'm not the only one. Miss Ralph and all the other good folks who put up the money.
Oh, well, money is one thing. What you did is something else.
Besides, I can understand the way Ralph felt. He was thinking about his situation with Edie if his first wife were to come back.
Exactly. And most of the others have folks lying at Edward Cemetery whose return might cause some problems. But you and Martha haven't got anyone at Edward.
By the way you're keeping after poor Carrie, you'd think he'd done something terrible instead of trying to put a stop to godlessness.
Martha, that's just what sticks in my craw. You and Carrie sure know what's right and what's wrong. Yet Carrie went ahead and committed what he must have known was a crime. And for what?
I told you.
You told me, but you haven't sold me.
When I found out what you'd done, I wanted to put you in jail.
I don't blame you.
Well, I do. Maybe Carrie did break the law, but you two are making a great big thing out of this like there was some importance.
Martha, there's a murdered girl lying in that cemetery, and her mother's frantic to have her brought back to life. But how do you think the murderer feels about it?
What are you saying?
That whoever killed Phyllis Thatcher would have a big stake in stopping this demonstration.
I can see that, Martha, but...
As I remember it, Phyllis used to work for you 3 days a week, Carrie. And I was wondering if you'd try to recollect if there were any friends that she had in particular. Maybe some young fellas who used to hang around. You know the sort of thing I mean.
Oh, sure, but I hardly saw her.
She wasn't a very good worker, you know.
No?
Martha, you oughtn't speak.
Then why did you keep her on, Martha?
Why don't you just take me to jail, Sheriff, and leave Martha alone?
Better ask Carrie why I kept her on.
Now, Martha, it's all over and done with.
What's over and done with, Carrie?
Oh, you know women. Martha somehow got it in her head that I was taking a shine to Phyllis.
Oh, taking a shine to Phyllis? Oh, my God. He was out of his mind about her, mooning over her like a lovesick calf. And she encouraging him, and the both of them laughing at their secret little jokes when they thought I didn't hear.
Now, Martha, calm down. You'll be getting one of your spells again.
Spells? Spells? That's what that little slut cast over you, all right. And you, worrying about whether she was doing too much.
Well, I was working my fingers to the bone, and the two of them always carrying on.
Whenever she had to go down to the cellar, Carrie would be running down those stairs like he was a boy of 16.
Martha, I'm telling you to keep quiet. Now, keep quiet.
It's just got to be too much for any decent woman to stand. And so I followed her one day, and I took
Martha.
I took care of that laughing and that giggling, that talking, and I killed her.
Please, Martha. Mrs. Windham.
Oh, don't worry, Lucas. I'm not hysterical. I just think it's so funny. I made myself a sinner. I killed that girl because I thought my husband didn't love me. And now look what he did just to stop my sin from finding me out. That's enough to make anyone laugh.
Come in.
Well, good morning, Mr. Mayor.
Morning, Professor. What brings you here?
I thought, seeing as how I was instrumental in helping you solve an old murder and catch a killer, that you'd change your mind and write me a letter of reference after all.
Oh, Professor, I admire your gall.
Oh, not at all, not at all. If you stop to consider, you must admit that without Marvelli and the notice of the demonstration...
Which never came off.
Only because some of your fellow townspeople wanted to pay me enough so that I needn't.
Admiring your call is one thing, but writing a letter to help you continue with this swindle is quite another. The only letter that I'll write for you is one stating that you helped a murder investigation. And if you don't want that... take yourself and your schemes and your newfangled motor car and get out of town.
It's difficult to believe in someone having the power to raise the dead. But how about fate? Here was a murder, undetected for a number of years, and finally uncovered only because a swindler chose Vesalia as the target for his scheme. For scheme it was. Records show that in the 19th century, there was a real-life con man who preyed upon the superstitious and the gullible by undertaking to raise the dead, and then accepting money not to do so. I'll be back shortly.
I'm sure a lot of us remember the motion picture, The Sting. But I wonder how many of us know that this was loosely based on a real swindle pulled off by the famous Yellow Kid and his partner, the Deacon. The Yellow Kid's real name was Al Weil, and he swindled people out of more than $1 million in his lifetime and spent a good deal of time in jail. However, when I met him one day, he gave me an unforgettable piece of advice. "Kid," he said to me, "remember, you can never con an honest man. Bankers are the best." Our cast included Ray Owens, Ralph Bell, Earl Hammond, and Marion Seldes. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.